default to a mute, and as speakers need to jump in to speak, you can unmute yourselves. So first and foremost, I want to thank everybody for joining this evening for the Peoria Complete Streets webinar. And obviously thank all the folks that are listed at the bottom of this that I've been lucky enough to work with. My name is Anthony Corso. I'm the Chief Innovation Officer for the City of Peoria, and have been lucky enough to be involved over the last 5+ years in helping develop policy practice that really are intended to improve residents' lives and outcomes and positive outcomes in the community. Complete Streets has been one of those key conversations, and it's included in everything from our overall plan for solving our combined sewer overflow to some of the neighborhood vitality work that's going on, some place-based economic development, and certainly a huge impact in the theme of recent conversations in terms of supporting active transportation for public health, for really providing a key strategy for transportation equity within communities. So also throw out a special thanks to the Active Transportation Alliance and Illinois Public Health Institute folks who helped pull this together this evening. And what I'll do is, if we can skip ahead one slide, just touch on a couple of housekeeping items before we dig in a little more. Like I mentioned at the top, please do stay muted during the presentation unless you are a speaker and it's your turn to speak. There's a number to type in if you are calling in rather than doing the actual video connection here. And what we'll do for folks that are not speaking is that if you do have kind of questions or comments you'd like to share, please add those to the chat. And again, in big red letters, this is being recorded, just so you all know. So we are gonna have this available for, I think, a good number of folks that were very interested but weren't able to make it tonight. And so that we can kind of share this in the future and get as much benefit out of it as possible. What I might do real quickly is call on Heather Shady from Active Transportation Alliance to give a real quick background on what has made this this webinar and some subsequent webinars, including actually some training that we did pre-pandemic, possible. So Heather, I'll turn it over to you just for a minute.
Thanks, Anthony. So really quickly, I just wanted to acknowledge our funder for this project. This webinar was made possible through funding from the UNIS Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, which is an extremely important partner of ours. The grant is being administered by the Illinois Public Health Institute, and Sarah, who's our controller of the webinar tonight, is one of the staff members that we work really closely with. And also, it's made possible with partnerships from the Illinois Alliance to Prevent Obesity, which Active Trans is a member of. Active Transportation Alliance, for those of you who aren't familiar with us, we're a nonprofit organization based in the Chicago region, but we are providing technical assistance to several communities through the ISPAN grant to focus on complete streets policy implementation and active transportation planning. And this is a 5-year initiative. We're in the very beginning of year 3, and we'll be continuing to work with Peoria over the next 3 years to help advance its complete streets implementation goals. So that's a really quick overview of our work, but you'll hear a lot more from Mark and Tim in just a minute.
Great, thank you, Heather. So really quickly, just a quick run of show for everyone as Mark Fenton gets, if we get Mark Fenton's PowerPoint queued up here. We're going to hear from Mark, Mark Fenton, and I'll let him give an introduction to himself, followed by some great kind of peer examples and lessons learned from Tim Gustafson, a senior planner at Epstein, and then we will dive into a local panel in some kind of Q&A after that, and I will introduce those panelists at that time. So to get us started, and without further kind of rambling by me, I'm going to jump in with Mark Fenton here and let him take it from here. Thanks, Mark.
Thank you, Anthony. It's great to be with you guys. I really feel like it's old home week for me because I was there in Peoria just over a year ago, back in May of 19. I had the privilege of joining Active Trans for a Safe Routes to School really focused workshop. We were over by Harrison Ellis Elementary, as you can see here, when we were out for our walk audit. But I visited Peoria before that, actually some years before, through the health initiative of a labor organization in the community. So I'm well familiar of a lot of the good work you've been doing. And I know we've got a lot of friends of the movement on this call. And I'm hopeful that what we're gonna do is help amplify the great work you're already doing, help you answer questions when others say, why should we be talking about complete streets? What's this all about? And in fact, I'm gonna give you my concluding slide right now. I'm gonna tell you, this is it. If you don't wanna listen to the rest of me, here's what it is. Peoria can't afford complete streets, right? They cost a lot. You got to put in these things like rain gardens that Anthony wants, and curb extensions, and ADA ramps, and protected bicycle lanes, and everything we paint on the street, we've got to paint again every year. It's going to cost too much. And I'm going to say to you, my answer to that is Peoria can't afford not to do complete streets. You cannot afford not to. You're in a competitive marketplace as a community, right? And we're trying, people are deciding whether to live there or not, and businesses are deciding whether to build there or not, and developers are deciding whether to develop there or not, and complete streets are going to be one of the strongest assets you can bring to those conversations. I can't say this enough. And by the way, the three images on the right are some of the lower cost sorts of complete streets activities that you've done, not unlike what Mike and I were just talking about, sort of changing the angle of the stripes for the motor vehicle parking there, for the back end parking, to make it safer for pedestrians, bicyclists, and motor vehicles. So that's my big takeaway. You can't afford not to do it as a community. And by the way, I would make this case to every community in the country that has not yet fully implemented complete streets. And I know you guys have passed a policy, but it's really now about institutionalization. So having said that, four quick things I'm going to hit on. I want to make sure we are clear on the health perspective and the health benefits. I want to talk about how the pandemic is only accelerating that need. I want to talk about the fact that there's an opportunity for what I would call institutional shift, that is not about somebody writing $1 million check tomorrow. It's more about changing everyday practices. And I'll conclude with my take on sort of what I call the triple bottom line. But a lot of people are using that term for healthy design. So the quick summary on public health is very straightforward, and our good friend Leslie could give you lots more detail on this and share with you the data if you need it for the region, for the state of Illinois. But we know we should be physically active. We know if you could get about 30 minutes of activity a day on average, it would reduce your risk for cardiovascular disease, type 2 diabetes, osteoporosis, clinical depression, dementia and old age, and a growing list of cancers, right? It is the closest thing we have to a silver bullet, and it doesn't have to be like these pictures. Everybody thinks physical activity means exercise, but the reality is these folks who are walking for errands or riding their bike in Peoria, if they get about 30 minutes a day of that kind of activity, they're going to get all those health benefits. That's the good news. The bad news is we don't do that. Our jobs are increasingly sedentary, our recreation is increasingly sedentary, and we've built a transportation system that really, in many ways, discourages us from being physically active every day. Big wide streets like on the top right there, and it shouldn't be surprising to us that now something approaching 50% of kids show up to school or more, 50% or more by car, as we saw at Harrison Elementary when we were there for our workshop last year. It's really common to see kids arriving and departing by car, even kids who live within what we would call walking distance. Now, having said that, there is a very clear understanding, and this is why the Centers for Disease Control is actually supporting this kind of work, that we can build environments that encourage routine physical activity. They can help shift our behavior. They may not be sufficient alone, but they are an absolutely necessary condition. And we know from the research that really four things characterize settings where people tend to be more active as part of their daily lives. A good mix of different kinds of destinations in proximity, a network of facilities for the active modes, walking, bicycling, and taking transit. When I get to a destination, it rewards me rather than punishes me for showing up without a car. It's got a site design like street trees and awnings and benches, and the building is at the street, not set behind a parking lot. And it's safe and accessible for absolutely everybody in the community, all ages, all incomes, abilities, and disabilities. I was going to make the very point that Mike made as we were opening up, that pedestrians benefit from that backed in car, because when we open the back door, kids go to the sidewalk, not to the street. And my mom is putting the groceries in from the sidewalk, not in the middle of the road. So it's better for drivers and pedestrians. So here's the really bad news, though. So we've got this clear picture. We know 30 minutes a day would do it. We know we can build communities where people would be more active. We know complete streets would help that be a reality. Well, I've been spending the last 25 years or so making that case, walking all over the country, including yes, Peoria, doing workshops like this, I think largely to no avail. If you look at vehicle miles traveled in this country over the last several decades, and we could go back further on this graphic, what you see is an inexorable rise until the 2008 Great Recession. And then it seemed to slow down. It looked like, oh, people were actually driving less as gas prices got to $4 a gallon. But of course, after the recession started to recede and the economy picked back up, it looked like, we're going to go right back to the same trajectory as far as vehicle miles traveled. And so it seemed until, of course, the pandemic. when vehicle miles traveled in this country absolutely plummeted. But that's because we essentially were shutting down our economy, closing down cities, people were working from home. Roads like this is I-93, the Interstate 93 in Boston, which would be a parking lot on any other day at that time at 5:30 in the afternoon. We got pictures of those empty roads all over the country, and those maps on the right show the dramatic improvements in air quality along the Eastern Seaboard, Pittsburgh, Cleveland, Detroit, just by virtue probably of that reduction in motor vehicle travel. The other thing that happened during the pandemic was that people demanded space to get out and walk and bike. They were asking to be able to get out and walk at safe social distancing to bike. They were taking over the streets, and cities were even adjusting. There's a picture from Denver, but I could show you dozens of photos of cities that widened sidewalks, that created temporary or pop-up bicycle lanes, that created slow streets in their neighborhoods. That's the Beltline Trail in Atlanta. Those signs aren't telling people not to get out and walk. They're saying, yes, be active. We know it's beneficial, actually, but maintain that safe 6-foot social distancing. So this was going on all over the country, and there was this demand for greater physical activity or space for physical activity, which Complete Streets would serve. Let me go a step further and say that organizations like the National Association of City Transportation Officials, which do a great job of laying out how we can build multimodal streets. They're not saying get rid of cars. They're saying we can build streets where motor vehicles, pedestrians, bikes, transit can all coexist really well. By the way, those two guides, it's the holiday season. If you know a transportation engineer or planner doesn't have them, buy them these books for Christmas. They are wonderful Christmas gifts. They're almost like coffee table books. But let me also say that NACTO, that same organization, published a great document called Streets for Pandemic Response and Recovery. And it summarizes some of those very immediate actions that cities and towns across the country were taking to respond to the demand. They show a bunch of case examples, how to widen the street, create space for pedestrians, on-street seating, waiting areas for pickup retail, takeout retail. That picture in the lower left is not actually from the pandemic. It's a pop-up protected bike lane from several years before and work I was doing in Whitefish, Montana. But it's the very kind of thing we were talking about. And here's why it's noteworthy. There were many people who said, you know what, parents aren't going to let their kids ride their bikes to school. You can make this bike lane.
What are you doing?
They're not going to let them do it because there are those big logging trucks that drive in our community. And everybody thought that was going to be the case until they filled the schoolyard with bikes. And they realized that that very inexpensive, short-term, totally reversible demonstration project actually proved to them that there was demand for bicycle facilities. They are now doing tremendous work on building the network. So I'm suggesting that there's a possibility that the kind of stuff we've done during the pandemic will fuel this discussion. But we really can't talk about all this without talking about the other big pandemic, which is about 4 centuries old in our country, which is institutional racism that was really brought to a boil this summer, but that many of us at work in the field recognize was really just bringing forward problems that we have known have been inherent in the institutional racism of even the work that we do in land use planning and transportation. And I want to make 2 points about this. Number one, as the pandemic has progressed, we have seen that the burden has fallen tremendously disproportionately on communities of color, much higher rates of the disease and death rates. And this is a fantastic interview on the New England Journal of Medicine. It's essentially a podcast that you can get at the New England Journal of Medicine website if you want more on that data. Dr. Michelle Evans just does an amazing job of laying out the horrible tragedy of this kind of disproportionate burden of the disease. Furthermore, many of us in this field have really been looking back at our history and at things like redlining and sort of the fact that we placed, you know, highways right through those communities with the least political power, the most people of color, lowest incomes, right? So we've got decades of that history, which is just contributing to the social injustice of sort of the circumstances we're facing right now. By the way, that's Rochester, New York, a town that I'm from that we'll revisit in a moment, where that's a giant trenched highway that was cut right through the historically African-American neighborhood. So let me summarize sort of the point up to this, my takeaway to this point. We've essentially hobbled the economy to battle an infectious disease that's likely to kill something like 300,000 to 400,000 of us. Yet every year, people don't realize about 400,000 Americans die to essentially the diseases of sedentary lifestyle and poor nutrition. That's our annual burden to unhealthy sedentary lifestyle. Is everybody clear on that? And we know that if we could get people just to walk and bike 30 minutes a day as part of daily tests, not exercise, not training for a marathon, walk your kid to school, ride your bike to downtown Peoria to go shop or to go to work or to the bus stop. we could reduce risk for not only those chronic diseases, but we also know that people who are at lower chronic disease risk also fare better if they do happen to get COVID. In other words, people with those comorbidities like cardiovascular disease, type 2 diabetes, fare much worse with COVID. We also know that people of color and the poor have experienced that burden much worse, much disproportionate, and that therefore, if there's a single prescription I could write, from a public health standpoint, it would be, let's build a world where more people across the spectrum of race and income could easily walk and bike on a regular basis. One last point. There is increased demand for places to walk and bike. We know that people are increasingly interested in local services like grocery, pharmacy, hardware. They don't want to drive their car to a giant mall or box store where the likelihood of pathogen exchange is much higher, right? And we know that accessible transit is really important for essential workers. So coming out of the pandemic, I suggest to you, complete streets is one of the most important things we could do from a public health standpoint. And there's really good evidence around that. And that means not just adopting a policy, but institutionalizing it at the agency level, which leads then to those more multimodal projects and to these broader community health benefits. And I do want to say, one of the big realizations, and by the way, I give credit here to Smart Growth America's Complete Streets for sort of capturing this. I had not seen this quote before. We shouldn't think of Complete Streets design as a product, a specific that road that now has got a bike lane, but rather a process. How we do land use planning, how we do transportation. And it's got to include things like our permitting practices and procedures, how we train engineers and planners, how we, what our design guidance is, what our performance measures are, that all of those are part of the institutionalization. Here's the good news. Agencies like the Federal Highway Administration are beginning to actually say this in that most pedantic way that they do, in the documents, in the guidance that they give. For example, they've published guidance on incorporating on-road bike networks during resurfacing, which was one of the cheapest ways to do this kind of work. You're repaving a road anyway. That's the time to think about, could we narrow the travel lanes, widen the shoulders, make bike lanes? They've published documentation on how to do road diets, how to convert 5 and 4 lane roads to 3 lane roads that are probably better for motor vehicles too, safer, and accommodate pedestrians, bicyclists, and transit better. Again, let me say this, the FHWA, Federal Highways imprint is on that document. How about performance measures? Is it all about level of service and average daily traffic? How many cars can we push through the pipe? Well, no, as a matter of fact, again, the FHWA has published their guidebook for developing pedestrian and bicycle performance measures. My point in showing each of these is to suggest that they, Federal Highway Administration and state transportation agencies increasingly around the country are saying, yeah, the way to do this is building it into your routine practices, thinking differently about what the transportation network looks like. And we're giving you guidance on how to do that, how to measure more than just the number of cars you push through. How about reducing vehicle miles traveled or improving health and equity outcomes or access for underserved communities or job and retail access? An example of this, by the way, a very concrete and specific one, a colleague that a few of us were on a great webinar with the other day, Ian Lockwood, said, we should stop talking about when we're doing one-way conversions back to two-way, we should be calling them restorations because those roads were historically two-way roads. And you think about some of the one-way streets in Peoria that have been discussed for possible restorations to two-way. We turn them into one-way roads just to move cars in and out of the suburbs faster, leaving aside all the impacts on the local neighborhoods, the street life, the local retail. Let's call those restorations as we think about turning them back into two-way. And by the way, I can't help but think that Lincoln up there in that top picture is looking at that road and said, who thought this was a good idea to turn this downtown street into a highway? I think that's what he's thinking in that picture. Doesn't he look like he's got the scowl on there up there? Simple things like maintenance checklists. For those who would make the argument, we can't do it, we're just under-resourced, we don't have the... I have worked with tiny rural communities through some of this same Centers for Disease Control funding that don't have two nickels to rub together. And if all we do is adopt a maintenance checklist where they ask simple questions like these anytime they're painting or paving a road, just during routine tasks, and make modest changes, narrow a travel lane, turn a shoulder into a bicycle lane, repair the sidewalk when you're repairing the road because you've got all the equipment out there at that time. Those are the kinds of things that we should be thinking about. Don't get bound by the notion that every complete streets project is a monumental undertaking. Here's my last point. I really want to finish up with this. All the evidence that we see building now suggests that should you do this, and that communities that do this, let me say it this way, are really reaping a triple bottom line benefit. I'm sure you've all heard this before, but I think it's important to know that there's a body of evidence around this. It says, build more complete streets, build more walkable, bikeable, transit-served communities, and you tend to see not just healthier people because they're being more physically active, but also healthier local economies and healthier environment. Now, Anthony could sing to us chapter and verse about the potential environmental benefits, so I won't beat that horse. But I'm gonna tell you, to my mind, this notion of people, prosperity, and planet is the reason that Peoria can't afford not to do this, and in particular, prosperity. We are seeing lots and lots of work out there that tells us that even the private sector recognizes walkability as a saleable asset. So we have organizations like the National Association of Realtors on the left, National Association of Home Builders on the right, routinely talking about walkability, about bicycle and pedestrian access, high quality transit as desirable attributes. I mean, when you get magazines like the National Home Builders magazine that says walkability, why we care and why you should too, that tells you something, doesn't it? Because they're saying, after I drive the last nail, all I want to do is sell this house. Walkability is going to help me sell this house. And indeed, this white paper is a great summary of a growing body of research suggesting that active transportation benefits the local economies in a lot of ways. Yes, real estate values, but also then the desirability for redevelopment. How about employee recruitment and retention? The fact that employers in communities that have invested in active transportation find it easier to recruit and retain employees. Employee health and productivity, not surprisingly, they're very well associated with physical activities, but also retail visibility and even sales volume. Let me say an interesting thing about this. For cities that have been suffering population decline in recent decades, which is common across the United States, you know, a lot of middle American cities of moderate size, this is a really common problem. What they're recognizing is often their youth go off to college, they all go off to jobs, they go off to military service, they experience different kinds of communities, and they simply don't come back. And in part, that's because that generation is very interested in biking more, in taking transit more, and driving less. And indeed, if you look at rates of driver's licensure among 16 to 24-year-olds, that peaked back in the early 80s at about 80% of kids in that age range having a driver's license. By 2012, it was down to close to 60%. By 2018, under 60%. We're talking, let me say this again, in the 16 to 24-year-old age range, 2 out of 5 kids don't have a driver's license. My daughter at age 22 is one of them, 23. And interestingly enough, I have to take her to the Registry of Motor Vehicles tomorrow because she may need to get her driver's license for some of the jobs she's applying for. But that's the only reason, not because she wants a car or wants to drive, because she sees her mobility in an entirely different way. Let's go a step further and say that there are a growing body of really interesting studies that actually look at retail activity on streets that are more complete streets. And this is my sort of final point on this. This study in New York City actually looked at roads where they did things like took entire travel lanes away, widened sidewalks, took away parking, on-street parking, and they measured dramatic increases in retail activity compared to control streets and to borough averages. Fine, you say, that's New York City unique. So they've now replicated that study. Portland State has now done it in 6 other communities around the country, and we're starting to see this and more, and we're tending to see the same results, which is increases in retail activity. And in fact, they also looked at employment, and they saw in particular, as you make a street more walk and bike and transit friendly, more complete street, right, you tend to see increase in also food employment. It's the kind of street where you can put some tables out and have a restaurant, right? And it's the kind of street where if I'm shopping on the other side of the street and I look across and I see something I want to go to, I can actually get there, right? Because we've built the street in a way that a pedestrian can navigate it just as well as a car. Here's my final point. The competition is not standing still. These are all communities of roughly comparable size around the United States that have complete streets policies and are doing this work. And I can say that because I've actually been in those communities and worked with them. So I'm taking no credit for their successes. I'm just saying they've committed, they're doing complete streets, they're institutionalizing into the routine practice of their public works, transportation, planning, engineering. It's how they look at the network now as a complete network. And they're Peoria's competition, to my mind, for your youth, for employees, for businesses. If the competition isn't standing still on this, I don't think Peoria should either. You can improve community health, respond to the demands of the PEP pandemic, make a more equitable transportation system, support local economies. You can boost employee recruitment retention, business recruitment retention, spur redevelopment. And if that's not enough, let me remind you, these are my kids who are now, as I told you, 22 and 25. And some of my friends here have seen these kids a bunch of times because I used to show them to say, it looks like at some point in the future, we were seeing articles like the one cited here in the top right, this generation could end up with the shorter life expectancies than their parents. Well, guess what? It's not hypothetical anymore. A year ago, the Journal of the American Medical Association published an article that said that's exactly what's happening. Kids who are being born today will have statistically shorter life expectancies because of their parents. And it was before the pandemic that we had this data. This was based on essentially reductions in life expectancy based on sedentary lifestyles and poor nutrition, unhealthy lifestyles. We can do better than that. And we know that how we build our communities is one of the strongest contributors. So I'm imploring you to take seriously the examples that Tim's gonna give, and the ideas that we have from our panelists today, as you think about how you're gonna apply that in Peoria, because we owe it to the next generation. So huge thanks both for having me previously as a guest and having me as an opportunity, you know, giving me an opportunity to talk to you about the great work that you're doing there and that I hope you're gonna continue to do.
All right. Thank you, Mark. And what I'll ask, we're gonna jump into Tim's presentation here in a minute, but just really quickly, if you have questions and thoughts that you wanna share, please do put them in the chat. As we go through the panel and start to get into some more of that discussion, we will try to address all of those at that time. Mark, thanks again. And one thing that I will reiterate for this group, because I know there's different levels of knowledge about what is happening in Peoria and what is happening in the greater Peoria area. The city did adopt an ordinance, a complete streets ordinance back in 2015, which is actually a really well put together ordinance. And, you know, one of the points of this effort was to kind of expand the education and understanding of complete streets to really make it known, not only is it still really important, but as we work to get better at implementing them, you know, this is something we want to share with the region. We want to continue to learn from other communities. And it is even a more important thing to consider now as we're going through the pandemic and looking at long-term recovery and the economic recovery of our community to be thinking about this as a primary strategy. So those things we'll talk a little bit more about in the panel discussion, but what I'll do now is I'll introduce Tim Gustafson. And Tim, if you could share a little bit about yourself and dive right into your presentation, that would be great.
Good evening, everybody, and thank you, Anthony, and thanks to Mark for the introduction. Mark's got some great energy and gives a great introduction into just the why about this. But before we get into mine, as Anthony mentioned, I want to introduce myself. I see some familiar faces in the attendance list. I've seen familiar faces on camera. But for those of you who I have not met, I'm very excited to be invited to speak here this evening. My name is Tim Gustafson, and I am a transportation planner with a company called Epstein. We are an architecture, engineering, and construction firm based in the Chicago region. We work statewide and around the country, and I'm in our planning group. I'm just coming up on my 15th year of being in the multimodal planning and transportation design world. I've been a big fan of walking, bicycling, and transit, but I also implement that in the context of the work that we do. So you probably heard Mark mention NACTO. I am NACTO certified. And actually, so for those of you who are seeing that acronym being thrown across the screen, I actually do have those two books that Mark suggests that you make as coffee table books and Christmas gifts. I think they're fantastic. NACTO keeps coming out with publications, and so does the FHWA at a rate that even I can barely keep up. But it's great information. Almost all of it is free. That's the other thing that I don't know if everyone is aware of. And so what I was invited to discuss tonight is in the 15 years or so of work that I've been doing, there's been a lot of movement with Peoria, as well as everybody else around the region and in the country about complete streets. And as I mentioned, Mark got into the why in a lot of ways, which I think is very important. And I thought maybe as a contrast, I would offer kind of a smaller scale, a way to discuss the how. And so what I've offered to provide for you this evening is a series of small case studies that talk about examples of what happens next. So Peoria has adopted a complete streets policy. That's a very important first step, and it's a wonderful achievement that you should be proud of, especially where you are in the grand scheme of its implementation. But what we run into, and I help consult on this in a lot of ways, is what do you do next? And so what I wanted to go through is just something as a primer before we get into those examples. But as I mentioned, you know, policy is always where we start. And usually I'm faced with the questions. I'm the one who goes before city council or the village board of trustees and said, okay, now what do we do? Because that policy is great. But what we need to know is how do we identify our projects? How do we program them? where do we find the money? And then how do we design them into the work that we already do? And as Mark touched on, which is very important, is we always feel that we can't afford it. Concerns over funding are what create this resistance. And then usually what happens is the first example is the bullet that you see here is, why does that project feel like an add-on? Why is that something special? Why does it stand apart? Why is it different? And why is it not an integral part of what we should be programming into our transportation investments? So one of the examples, as Mark mentioned, is you're able to recite or resurface and take advantage of that opportunity. So if roadway space can be reallocated, just changing what's there from edge to edge, and if you can incorporate bike lanes at that time, that's an example of just one type of complete streets improvement that can be a marginal increase in cost. I mean, we're talking like less than 0.5% in most cases. Sometimes when motor fuel tax or surface transportation funding is already programmed, I have clients that say, can you add some pavement marking plans and a signage plan, because we can just give this in our quantities to our contractor and it's already included within the typical scope of work. That's a way to actually just under the radar, it gets done. And then the last one, we always run into one of these is, if you've done this and you've already gotten it out of your system, if you've had a project that feels like a boondoggle and it is more costly than it should have been, the good news is now you know what not to do, and we can move on to different ways to make that easier and better. So the growth and evolution of Complete Streets actually follows kind of four major points that I want to touch on. And I have consulted with and had the fortune of working in communities that have embraced Complete Streets, and they're implementing it for different reasons. And I wanted to share these because you can pick any of the reasons that work best for you. And then you can use that as your message to get people to get on board with the concept, its implementation, putting it into practice. So the first one, freedom and independence. If you're able to walk and bike some of those shorter trips, that helps you reduce the need for that second car in your garage. And maybe if you're the type of person who can live a car-free lifestyle, you may not need a car at all for most trips, and you can rent one if need be. So that frees up household resources. We are constrained in our own household finances. If you don't have to fill the tank with gas as often, that just frees you up for other kinds of spending, which may be very important. Mitigate risk. For those of you who are fortunate enough to have a retirement plan, you know that you're not investing in one thing. Your advisor wouldn't tell you, your blended funds at your employer wouldn't advise that. You've got the ability to diversify. Think of your transportation network as an investment. You wish to diversify so you can mitigate risk, and you recognize that you can seek efficiencies from different types of investment in different places of your city, of your spending. And then the third one, I have to say, I call this the common sense one. Where do you walk the dog? If you leave the house and there's no sidewalk, where are you parking when friends come over to visit? Where is your lawn maintenance vehicle parking the car? Where is the babysitter, delivery person, mail delivery? Sometimes the greatest advocate I have for adding shoulders to rural roads is your mail carrier, just saying I can actually pull over into something that's not mud. And then the last one, crash modification factors, which the Federal Highway Administration cites. Adding sidewalks to a roadway that doesn't have them reduces crashes by 88%. And we're not just talking people walking. We're talking every kind of crash goes down. And that's the number that gets trotted around because it is repeatable and has withstood the test of time in a lot of contexts. And my predecessor and mentor, I've been very fortunate to be trained under John LaPlante. That was always one of the very first slides he would give. And so I want to start with that. And now I'd like to go into a couple of examples of cities that you may not have expected would have embraced Complete Streets and what they've done with that information. So the first one I want to talk on is very conservative town in Oklahoma called Pryor, Oklahoma. I was on a part of a team that was doing their first comprehensive plan in more than 30 years. And there were council members that were on all sides of the issue. Some that were not even familiar with what the term was being used for and why it was part of the comprehensive planning process. They thought of it as a land use assignment. And there was one council member, and I remember he was very excitable, but very like easy to talk to. And he was a great guy that came at the problem from a very interesting perspective. And he said, you know, I don't see much about this bicycling bed. I don't think that's really something that our town is going to embrace. But I do like the idea when my wife and I drive to our downtown that we could park the car once and then we can go about to a couple of different places. And there's ways to walk and cross the US highway. And he actually thinks that that would be something that his town could get behind. Because if you frame the conversation in, I'd like to be able to park on this main street and not have people speed and have somewhere to walk, and be able to see around the corner when I'm trying to cross the street and have a light that tells me when it's okay to walk, he kind of embraced it. And he started to see that this was a benefit. And so Pryor became the first city in the state of Oklahoma to pass a complete streets ordinance. And they did that in 2016. Mind you, I was working on their comprehensive plan in 2014 and 15. So one of the recommendations was to adopt a complete streets ordinance. And I admit, when I finished the work, I had to go back and see if they actually did it. And I was very heartened to find out that they had. So I consider that a minor win in a state where I don't work very often, but I do know that by changing how we talked about it, people started to understand, I don't need to call it complete streets. I need to call it, let's plan for a walkable downtown. The next case study I want to talk about is La Crosse, Wisconsin. I love the city of La Crosse. It is a college town. It's on the Mississippi River. It's on the Bluff. It's a beautiful city. And they passed a complete streets ordinance in 2012 when we were working on their bicycle and pedestrian master plan. It's got a significant healthcare population. And so the healthcare discussion about complete streets was already alive and well. And that hospital campus actually straddles US 1461. So you have people crossing the US highway, four lanes, several times a day for appointments, for lunch to get to their car. And they were one of the first parts of the state of Wisconsin that started to implement the mid-block crossing with the flashing beacons. This was back when they were very new. And they were doing so even before we got involved. And so they recognize that there's a need to intervene on our surroundings because it's not good enough if we as healthcare professionals are espousing what we need to do and we can't even cross our own campus. So they were a very big part of the plan. And then when we finished implementing the plan, we were talking about the concept of neighborhood greenways, which we can come back to if there's questions. Bike boulevards is another term for it. And it's not doing anything specific to a roadway, but you kind of calm everything down just so that people can walk and bike more comfortably. And they had recently passed a stormwater utility ordinance to deal with localized flooding in residential neighborhoods. That actually created a tax upon homeowners because they really needed to tackle flooding. And this was the only way, and they had been wrestling with this for a while. The one thing that came out of that is if you're able to reduce or offset your stormwater impact, you actually get a credit towards that tax. And the tax actually created a funding stream that allowed the city to intervene and develop engineering solutions to trap stormwater where it fell. And one of the ways to do that is this concept of a rain garden or a bump out. And La Crosse called them bioswales, not bioswales. They basically are curved areas of the roadway that allow for inlets into an open permeable area to allow water to just go into the ground rather than into the storm sewer. And so the bulleted or the bold text here is the city engineer kind of said, you know, we don't have funding for bike ped improvements, but we do have funding for stormwater improvements. And if this stormwater improvement happens to calm traffic, maybe we can pay for part of this bike boulevard using our stormwater utility funds. And that's exactly what they've been doing since 2016. And they now have 2 to 3 bike boulevards crisscrossing the city. That they didn't realize that they had the funding to pay for because we changed the messaging here saying it's not just a bike improvement, it's a stormwater improvement that has a bicycle benefit. So that's another example where don't think of it just as complete streets for certain user groups. Start thinking about how your streets are more complete, even from a stormwater management perspective. It just happens to bleed over into these other benefits. There's another city. This one's a little closer to home for me. This is just about an hour away from where I live. Warrenville, Illinois is in DuPage County, Illinois, pretty conservative for the Chicago metro area. And they're a bedroom community with a pretty good tax base because of how close they are to some major employers. So they have a lot of a residential network, a lot of tollways and DuPage County highways crisscrossing through there, but they're close to some of the best forest reserve trails in the region. And they recognize that by getting people excited about living in Warrenville, letting them get to trails is part of what they can sell as a bedroom community. So they passed their complete streets ordinance in 2019. And the first thing that the public works director wanted to do was say, okay, I need to improve the efficiency with project programming and development. And he was embracing the concept of complete streets, but he actually would have to go to the city council every time he needed to appropriate funds to do a local match for a county project, a tollway project, a forest preserve project, or any kind of other local match where it wasn't them just spending money on their own roads, but they wanted to participate in a cost share on a project that was gonna help them connect to these trails. And he found that to be very inefficient. And so we consulted with them to help write the complete streets policy and then also go through a cost estimate exercise that said, okay, how much really would it cost for us to add sidewalks on one side of every street in our village or our city if we just had to do it today? And so we gave them a number and we were able to break that down and say, if you were to build it out over a 10-year period, here's how much you would spend every year for 10 years. And if you're able to find funding and seek a little bit of assistance, you can reduce your burden by this much. And so by chipping away at that number, he finally got to a number that he was able to go before city council and said, what I would prefer to do is as we develop our capital improvements plan moving forward, I would like to set aside a certain amount of use it or it goes back into the general fund of pre-appropriated local match and project development dollars from the budget we already have, not asking for anything bigger than what's in there, but pre-allocate what's already been set aside. Make me come before the city council that much less often. Our projects can develop more quickly and we don't miss the funding cycles that we can go after when we team up with the county or the forest preserve. So this was one where it had very little to do with actual projects, but he really just wanted to find efficiency in the way that we program, the way that we spend the money we already have. Moving on to my second to last or third to last, Northbrook. I am embarrassed to admit I'm working with the village and they don't currently have a policy or an ordinance on the books, but they do have the Complete Streets policy ideas in their master bicycle and pedestrian plan. And they have since been very aggressive in implementing it. And one of the things they did during this was they convened a bicycle task force to make sure that the village residents are holding the engineering and the village elected officials accountable, saying, how are you incorporating the bike plan into your capital improvements process? And how can we make sure that these are folded in? And the quote at the bottom is from the village engineer, who is a former engineer from District 2 of IDOT, who has seen the light and has basically embraced this and said, you know, it really makes more sense to do our stormwater, our water main, our bike ped, our accessibility, our roadway resurfacing and reconstruction projects all at the same time. So when you know you need to touch a roadway, do it efficiently so they know we're being efficient with our resources. And I've been assisting and helping them write grants to expand their capacity. We'll talk about grants later on if there are questions, but basically by going through this process, they're now able to seek funding that they would not otherwise have been eligible for. And they know that by doing so, they're able to make the case for saying, we're gonna be comprehensive about this. And we've now opened ourselves up to a new funding stream. It may be very competitive, but it's something we wouldn't have had otherwise. And then I think this, two more, Decatur. They have no policy, but the DUOTS, which is their MPO, has a policy. And they have had a very active park district over the years. Last 10, 15 years, they've been building out their trail network. And they've created an award-winning trail network. And then they kind of got to the edge of their limits and said, okay, we've obtained all the federal funding we can get our hands on, but we don't have jurisdiction on the road. And so the next time there was a bike plan update done, it was the city who led it with great support from the park district. And they have given them the, here's how programming works. Here's how you write a grant. Here's how you go after this. And so this is the first time that the city is actually implementing the bike and ped plan. And we've been assisting, helping them build out from the trail network that they view as their spine. And then the last one that I want to talk about, this one is near and dear to my heart because actually Heather worked on this with Epstein. So Active Trans was part of our team and helped write, and actually Heather wrote and went before the village board, and the Complete Streets policy was adopted in the fall of 2019. Beach Park is unique in that it's located so close to Lake Michigan, but has no shoreline. Illinois Beach State Park is in the way, which is a wonderful asset. It's a beautiful lakefront. It is Beach Park's front yard, but they can't get to it. So one of the reasons they did the Northern Lakeshore Trail Connectivity Plan was to capitalize on that, find those trail connections and make those partners so that they can actually work with other agencies that have land use jurisdiction where they would like their residents to be able to visit. So Lake County Division of Transportation, the Forest Preserve District and Beach Park work together now and they've got regular meetings. And I'm happy to say that they were able to submit a transportation enhancement program grant to close some gaps on one of their major north-south roads that's under the jurisdiction of the state. And when collecting letters of support from business owners and people in the community, they talked to an employer who has a convenience store right on Sheridan Road and asked if he would support this. And he said, well, of course, because I employ 8 people, but only one of them drives here. Everybody else either gets a ride or they're walking on this very narrow sidewalk. So a true example to the economic benefits of doing so. This is now providing access to people to get to work. It's a safer option for people to walk and bike to get to the lakefront. And this was a 5-municipality plan. So everybody who participated in the plan basically spent about 12 cents on the dollar to get local technical assistance funds that then produced, I think, Heather, correct me if I'm wrong, $115 million of trail programming that they now can chip away at by going after grants that they wouldn't have been very competitive in seeking before that. And now Beach Park may have a chance at having access to Lake Michigan. So I know I went through those very quickly, but I did want to use those as kind of those smaller scale miniature case studies to show you that complete streets are not any one thing. And I will have to admit that I've been surprised that as much as I like drawing the plans and doing the designs, being able to help them on the inner workings and the operational behind the scenes stuff has been very rewarding, because it's truly started to unlock and unhinge some of those sticking points. And I wanted to offer those as a few examples this evening. So thank you very much for your time. I'm gonna turn it back over to the group and stop sharing my screen. And I can follow up with questions when they arise. So thank you.
All right, thank you very much, Tim, for sharing kind of the lessons learned that you are able to bring to the table. What I'm gonna do, I'm gonna turn it back over to Mark here in a minute, but first I wanna introduce our local panel that's going to kind of take to the screen next. So I'll start and just run through and do real quick, brief introductions. If folks wanna give a little bit more context, they can, but then I'll hand it over to Mark to kind of run through some prompts for some discussion, which is I think really always where we kind of can get into some of the deeper dives on details and help people understand and accelerate some of this work. So first we have Sid Ruckriegel, who's an at-large city council member for the city of Peoria, also a developer. And we have Dr. Leslie McKnight with us from the Peoria City County Health Department. Mark Misselhorn, who's the chair of the Downtown Advisory Commission and an architect. Gabriel Guevara, who is a board member of Bike Peoria. And then we have Mike Van Cleve, last but not least, Mike, who's a representative of Advocates for Access and a local real estate professional, among other things. So if you jumped on early enough, you also know that he's quite good at baking. So with that, I will hand it over to Mark kickstart this discussion. Thanks.
Well, great. And it's a privilege to be able to visit with this great panel. You guys are all, thank you so much for making the time to join the group today. So I'm going to ask us to start with sort of a quick one. You know, we hear that there are a lot of challenges to completing complete streets. They cost money, they take extra time, they complicate planning processes, things like that. So if you would, would you sort of just quickly add anything to your self-introduction that particularly explains the relevance of complete streets to your work? In other words, sort of why is it that the world you live in as, for example, a city councilor, you know, that matters to you? And what do you think one of the most compelling reasons for Peoria to try to institutionalize complete streets implementation? So, you know, essentially, again, I'm asking you for your lens, you know, what is it that in your position, sort of, you've got a perspective on complete streets, and the single most, so we're not looking for a soliloquy here. This is just sort of, we'll run through the five of you first, and you just give sort of that most compelling reason, if you would, from your perspective. And I'll just call you guys out by name just to kind of move us through. So Sid, would you mind going first?
Great.
You mind that I'm calling you Sid, by the way? I apologize. I got really familiar
That's perfect.
Nice.
Now, for me, it really comes to the economics and the economic driver. Not only do we know that the health benefits will lower our community medical costs, which is a great driver and a very important need, but it helps bring equity to our full workforce to be able to give accessibility, multimodal transportation to be able to get to the places we need to, either for employment, for retail, for shopping, for enjoyment. We often think of the impact of as this just recreational, and it is so much more. We know that vacancies are less and lower term for commercial properties that are along complete streets. And so when we're really looking at growing the population of Peoria, this is a key point to be able to retain and grow our population, because place is so important right now. The pandemic taught us that. And we can actually use this as a calling card as to why to call Peoria home.
Cool. Great. Wow. That's a great summary. And I'm glad you're in the position to be able to make that case from where you are. Leslie, totally appropriate that Sid alluded to those health benefits. So Leslie, kind of give us your lens on this.
Yes. Well, thank you, Mark, for framing the public health case. You kind of stole my thunder. I don't need to do that deeper dive, but what I will say is I'm representing not just the Peoria Health Department, but our health systems, OSF, Unity Point, our other health departments in our regions and community health organizations. Every 3 years, it's called Partnership for a Healthy Community. And we do a tri-county-wide community assessment to identify what our health priorities are. And obesity from the research, which includes the hospital data and community surveys, obesity was the number one health priority. For the Tri-County region, we have one of the highest obesity rates for populations in the state of Illinois, and we're above average for the state of Illinois obesity rates. In addition to that, the other health priorities was cancer, mental health, and food insecurity. And data shows that all of this is connected to lifestyles, right? And having what is your level of active and physical lifestyle. So for the whole health systems, this is our priority. We're working on collective interventions to increase healthy eating and also active living. So that, you know, that is our lens, but from a Complete Streets perspective, I'm going to put on the lens of equity, right? Equity is removing barriers and increasing access, right, for healthier outcomes. So our overall goal is active transportation for all. So regardless of your economic, social status, where you live, your physical mobility, everyone should have the right and the access for options in transportation to get where you have to go. And also, if you're just choosing to have a more active lifestyle, if you want to do more biking, running, walking, you should have choices as well to get around where you're at. So that's our overall goal.
Outstanding. And of course, those are all related because, for example, as you talked about things like access to, and this was also in the chat box, so I want to acknowledge that people were talking about access to care, for example, to healthcare,
yes,
but also access to healthy food choices. You want every household to have that access, not just car owning households or not just households that own multiple cars, right? You need a multimodal transportation system to even get those just essential services like healthcare, access to healthy food choices.
Absolutely.
Thanks for that reminder, Leslie. Let's see, I'm just going through my list here. Mark, you're next on my list, if you wouldn't mind.
Okay, I like your first name, Mark.
Yeah, you too, my friend.
Great, and thanks for your introductory remarks and also from Tim's. They were really very informative, very, very interesting. I'm on this panel because I'm the chairman of the Downtown Advisory Commission, and Peoria's downtown is the key to Peoria's future. It's critical for the success of our entire city and our entire region. And it's a compact downtown, but to make it, to continue the success and momentum that's occurring downtown, the idea of complete streets, walkable downtown environment, all the things we're talking about, safety, health, quality of life, attractiveness, vibrancy, sustainability, accessibility, is exactly what we need more and more of. And it does, and you know, as we've said, the Peoria does have a complete streets policy, and that's a great thing, but implementing it and making it, you know, front of mind in every aspect of every project. There are great things coalescing in Peoria now downtown. Just before this meeting, we had an update from the city and the consultants on, and I love the term restoration of two-way streets versus conversion.
Yeah.
It's been a subject of discussion for decades, and it's going to happen for some of our major streets downtown, step by step, incrementally. But those kinds of things are real game changers. And so, as Sid said, it's about attractiveness. It's about retaining to grow our city. First of all, we have to stop losing population. We have to make it attractive to stay and to return to. But there's so many reasons, like, you know, baby boomers, and we could be a great attraction for people that are retiring, a low cost of living, great quality of life.
Absolutely.
Go into, it's not just getting millennials to move here. It's all of those things, not either or, it's that and. So the last thing I would add is that downtown is also the locus of our healthcare. We're a regional healthcare center, and it is really a huge part of our city's future as well. And so it makes perfect sense to tie all these things in, as Leslie mentioned, with quality of life and quality of health as a regional healthcare. So I think it's a perfect fit, and the time is now.
Great. A great point, by the way. I'll just reiterate that. We saw a great presentation, Anthony and Leslie, and Ray, you were on that call, I think, from the National Association of Realtors, the data on that. And they said that that's absolutely right. It's not just millennials. It's not just those younger generations. We're seeing, for example, empty nest baby boomers want to be in communities where they can walk to a coffee shop, to the local brew pub or a restaurant, to a theater, right? Have that active life and not have to start a car for every one of those trips. So you're absolutely right about that. This kind of can be, there are a lot of population targets for a more balanced transportation community. Great. Gabrielle, where do you come in on this?
Hi. Yeah. So I am a board member for Bike Peoria, which is a community organization here in Peoria that focuses on, you know, bicycling and promoting bicycle safety. And so that's where we're coming from, just like interested in promoting safety for bicyclists, but not just bicyclists, but like everyone who wants to use the street. And also to an important benefit to implementing complete streets for Peoria is that it allows, you know, more people to engage in the community and not just, you know, those who own cars, but pedestrians and bicyclists and people who want to, like, use the bus as well. That's where we're coming from.
Great. I assume you're a regular bike rider. How do you feel the network is performing now? Because I know lots of folks who study this stuff will say, you know, a very experienced cyclist can kind of ride on any kind of road, right? But as we begin to expand the net, as you've just described, there are an awful lot of people who are not going to be comfortable being right in traffic, right? Acting like a vehicle. Not everybody has that skill set. Thoughts on that regarding Peoria's system?
Well, the funny thing is, even though I'm a part of Bike Peoria, I myself am not a bicyclist. So like I haven't ridden a bike around Peoria, but like just, you know, just driving around and just like walking around. Well, I'm more pedestrian. And like I realized that I live on like a cul-de-sac, and like at the end of the cul-de-sac where like it turns into like the main road, the sidewalk stops. And there's no more. Yeah. So I realize, you know, there's the Peoria's sidewalk network could be better filled in.
Those kinds of discontinuities in the network can be the very thing that discourages from somebody from choosing that mode, right? Walking and biking the same. Great. Mike, give us your perspective on this.
Absolutely. And before I do that, I will tell you, Bike Peoria and the Bike Co-op is one of the city's best undervalued assets. The fact that somebody can go and donate a bike that these guys will fix up or teach somebody how to fix up and then sell to be able to provide bikes to kids. It's an incredible, incredible asset. So thanks for your work, guys. So my background, I come at this from a fairly unique perspective. I study architecture at the University of Illinois, where I also played wheelchair basketball, ILL to folks out there. So I played wheelchair basketball and graduated and went to work for a nation's leader in accessibility consulting and universal design. Sorry, it's been a while since I had some water. I had the unique perspective to work with everybody from mom and pop businesses all the way up to Fortune 100 companies, developers who had built 300 to 500 unit multifamily mixed use developments, And what was interesting was they were either needing our services because they're being sued by the Department of Justice or the local state attorney general's office, or and the cost to do those modifications was so significantly more expensive than had they incorporated those things into their design from the from the get-go. So when we look at things from a 4% of the world's, or from the US population, has some kind of physical disability, we look at parents with strollers, the idea of universal design, the seven principles of universal design, and how that incorporates and kind of goes parallel to the idea of complete streets. This is not necessarily a new idea, and a lot of architectural and engineering, you design with kind of the worst case scenario. So the factor of safety when it comes to your structure or your mechanics. But when we look at accessible design, universal design, complete streets, the accessibility part of it, or the universal design, is very much of an afterthought. And so the ramp goes onto the building and it's ugly because we don't begin with the end in mind. So if we look at it from the perspective of how do we design for the most susceptible or the most needy in our community from an equitable standpoint, we get a much better built environment. Mm-hmm. And from a business standpoint, it's easier to sell, it's easier to use, and it attracts more people to come here, stay here, and want to live here. So.
Fantastic. Wow, great summary. That's really kind of a great, concise summary. All right, if you don't mind, I'm going to jump right to the next question. You've kind of laid the groundwork, given us all your perspectives on this, your insights. So it's going to be two questions. We'll do one and then the other. And the first one, I want to do it a speed round. This will be hard, but go with me on this. Just try this. I'm going to ask you, what do you think one of the real challenges to the implementation of complete streets in Peoria is? And I want this to be sort of like a six-word answer. So in other words, because then we're going to come back around and my next question is going to be, so I'm setting these up so you can be thinking about this. I'm giving you time now to think about what your six-word answer. Tim, I'm going to warn you, I'm going to ask you to jump in on this one too if you want to, okay? So here's the first is real barrier. And don't just say we don't have enough money. I mean, sort of say what the reality of that is. Okay, why? But a concise answer, real challenge to the implementation, the routine implementation of complete streets in Peoria. But then when we come around again, the second time I'm going to say, I'm going to give you a magic wand, essentially, to solve that problem. What would be your policy solution? What would be your systemic approach to solving that problem? Okay, so now we're getting concrete, and I want to get a little more practical, unique to Peoria. Did you hear something, for example, in Tim's presentation? He said, we ought to be trying that. Or did I trigger something for you? Or have you been working on something you think's a solution? So first time through, we're going to go through. I'm going to start with somebody else this time. Is in a fairly concise answer, real challenge to implementation here. And then come back through and I'll say, okay, what's your solution? And you're allowed to have a magic wand. The magic wand, by the way, allows you that you don't have to go through the legislative process. Sid, you don't have to convince all of council to vote it. You just hit it with the wand and it's gonna happen, okay? That's what I'm gonna, but who's, is anybody itching with your answer as to the big barrier right now? Is anybody ready to jump on that? Okay, Mark, go for it, buddy.
I think it's perception that it's not going to be well used or it's unnecessary. People would say, I don't ride a bike. Nobody, who would ride a bike?
Yeah, nobody's going to ride there anyway. I never seen a bike on that road.
It's kind of like Mike, you know, has heard this where you say, well, we don't need a handicap ramp. No one ever comes there in a wheelchair, you know, literally.
Yeah, right.
A lot as an architect. So that's my opinion.
And we've got a cause and effect problem there. Is it possible nobody ever comes there in a wheelchair because they can't get in the building?
Exactly.
Is it possible we don't ride a bike on that road because it's absolutely threatening to be there on a bicycle? Maybe that's the problem. Yeah. Okay, Mark, got it. Excellent answer. Nice and tight. Gabrielle, you have one for me?
Yeah, I was going to say kind of like similar to like perception, maybe a lack of education or awareness of like what complete streets is and like the benefits to having it.
Yeah. Okay. So here it is. It's a great idea. What does that really mean? What do I mean? Mike, do you have an answer on this one?
Yeah. It seems like people seem to think that it's like eating an elephant. You know, the problem seems so big, but when we look at it, all you have to do is the first next step. And yep. So if people just took the minimally viable next step, mm-hmm. ultimately look back and see how far we came.
Yep. It's sort of, you don't have to build all 27 miles of missing sidewalk now. Get the 300 feet in that goes in during that project. Great.
You don't have to make best idea. You just have to make a good next step. Yeah.
Good. Great. Sid, do you have one that comes right immediately to your mind?
I think it comes to the perception that with limited finances for a city, that those we don't talk about the investment and what the real return is and the broad range. Or in doing so, we also assume that a complete street has to be done in only one way and that there can't be modifications that might fit within our budgetary constraints and those situations. It's not a one size fits all.
Okay. One size fits all. Excellent. Like that. Leslie?
I would say status quo and the post-industrial revolution and suburbanism, where we just send these templates to get traffic through, to go to the suburbs. Mm-hmm. And, you know, the suburbs are great. And a lot of suburbs actually have a lot of these as amenities. And that's fine. And I love it. But how do we make that, you know, part of the entire community? So I say status quo and dreaming. We need to dream more.
Yeah, fair enough. A quick side note, and I just want to point this out because we heard this great presentation. The National Association of Realty guys, a lot of people said post-pandemic, everybody's going to want to escape to the suburbs because they're going to want low density, get away, right? That's the only way I'm going to be safe from COVID or something like that. Right. And their data from NAR suggests that's not necessarily the case. They may not want to be in downtown Manhattan, right? They don't want to be in that kind of density. A lot of people feel medium-sized cities are going to be the ones that thrive coming out of the pandemic. Places that can provide your goods and services and a quality of life and transportation options, right? Where I could have a corner store, a coffee shop, the grocery, pharmacy, hardware down the street. They may be the best positioned coming out of the pandemic because people we're not going to just escape out into the country like it's The Walking Dead or something. We still need those day-to-day services, and we don't want to have to drive to giant malls to get to them. It could be that the Peoria-sized communities of the world will be the best position, which I think builds on some of what you're saying. Hey, Tim, do you want to add to the list of challenges? Do you have one that you would add? That, although these guys, I think, gave us a pretty good picture of where Peoria is.
Yeah, it's always a challenge. This is one of those games where you wish you get called on sooner because then you have more items to pick from.
Yeah, everybody else.
Mike and Leslie and Sid came up with such great ideas.
Yep.
But the one thing that I was thinking I might offer is that one of the bigger challenges people feel, at least from my perspective, is that it's specialized or that you need to be an expert in order to even dip your toe into complete streets. And that's not necessarily the case. And I don't want to give the solution until you give the magic wand question. But perception that it's got to be this like super special, you know, only invite the Marks and Tims. It's like, that's not the case.
The ta-da idea. Ta-da. Yeah. All right. Mm-hmm. Hey, let me add two quick comments that came out of the chat box that I think are pretty thoughtful contributions to this. Andy Stowe said, hey, look, we go to build this stuff. We got to remember that we have to maintain it. We got to clear snow in the winter, you know, sort of. So that becomes a challenge, right? Once I paint that bike lane, I got to paint it every year. I've got to plow it. I've got to keep it clear. I've got to deal with those vertical delineators if you've put them in the ground and they get run over and bent over. So a great insight there, Andy, on that. And Beth Jensen made the point. She said, you know, we do have council members who are now serving who weren't even here when we passed the complete streets policy and sort of getting them, you know, when we talk about educational targets, the population at large, you know, advocates, like Gabriel's group, but also how about decision makers, sort of bringing them on board with sort of the reality behind this, that you know, so that we have greater continuity of the understanding. Okay, great. Thank you for those contributions, guys in the box. Excellent. All right, then I'm going to come back around, and now you have your magic wand in your hand. And with it, you can, for example, you can't, by the way, print money with your magic wand. This is important. You can't just say, we now have $7 billion. You could say, I will put in place a policy that will generate revenue in the following manner, right? You know, and so I've worked in communities that have, like, you know, resort communities where they say, we're going to put in place a resort tax and use that to build our bike network or something like that. But you can pass legislation without sort of getting it voted, if you want to make that kind of a policy change. So I'm going to look for a recommendation from each of you. Mark, are you ready to go again? Because we could go the same order again, give everybody time to think about it, but are you ready?
I'll give it a shot. This is not my answer, but this is a policy. I think one of the best things the city of Peoria has done in recent years has gotten rid of parking minimums.
Good, great.
That's a big part of all of what we're talking about.
So we don't end up with these giant surface lots just because it's so many per thousand square feet of retail. Good call.
Yeah, so that would have been my answer, but we already did that, which was, I think, you know, it's interesting that Councilperson Beth Jensen had brought up the fact that I think that would be my recommendation would be a policy session that the council, and we'll have a new mayor in the spring as well. And I think a reiteration of the importance of this and to the seated council and mayor of what we've done as a summary and what we're doing now and what we need to do moving forward. And it's a citywide thing. I'm very focused on downtown, but it's a citywide thing. So that would be my suggestion, would be a policy session and really focusing on with the decision makers and key city staff as well about let's keep this front and center.
Wow, that's really concrete. And Beth Jensen's already given you bravos on that. She thinks she's the one that raised that question. So excellent. Great. Gabrielle, do you have an idea for your magic wand?
Yeah. I feel like when it comes to like tackling like education and awareness, like hosting like workshops like these, or even like visioning sessions to like get people to get a sense of like what it would be like to like actually like be on like a complete street, you know, and stuff like that. So like I feel like.
And in fact, our friends at Active Transportation Alliance have done tremendous work on this. And in the chat box, there are a couple of great video links to some of their examples of what we would call pop-ups or demonstration projects, like that temporary one I showed the picture of the bike lane in Montana. But they've done tons of that kind of stuff where you can actually let people try this stuff, but at very low cost, even fully reversibly. You're not even sticking anything in the pavement. So nobody has to say, oh, no, what if it doesn't work? And let people have that experience. And I bet Bike Peoria would be great partners.
Let me interrupt for a second, Mark.
Yeah, go. Do it now.
At the end of the workshop here, we can, you know, spare the lat. If you want to hang on for five more minutes, we can play a video. We can share a video.
Good. Let's do that. Let's show one of those. You guys have some great examples. But Gabriel, I think you're making an important point. Not everybody sort of drinks this Kool-Aid. This isn't everybody's life. You know, this is the work a lot of us do all the time. What about people who don't? Let's give them an opportunity to see it, feel it, experience it. Outstanding. Mike.
Absolutely. I wanted to touch real quick. We'll say when the city did the University and Main Street redesign, we've seen the days on market for the Uplands neighborhood drop by a third. And, you know, detractors will say, oh, well, you know, that's because, you know, people are moving out and they don't want to, you know, but what we're seeing is we're seeing a younger demographic moving into that neighborhood who want to be walking to places. They want to park their car on Friday. They don't want to touch it until Monday.
Yeah.
And they like the fact that, so I will also say as a realtor, I had three conversations this week alone from folks from the greater Seattle area and from folks from Chicago and one from New Jersey, all of who see from between a 25 to 35% decrease, making the same income they're making in their communities now with job offers here as a value for moving to the Peoria area. And these are people who are looking into our heritage neighborhoods, mm-hmm. You know, and so great value there. So from a policy standpoint, all city staff are required to say yes and. So no is off the table at the beginning, because when you say no to an idea, what you do is you shut down the road. When you say yes and, like my daughter asked for a cookie for breakfast, I say yes and, what is that going to do to your diet? And so we're entertaining the idea and we might get to know, but where we go in that process provides us for design iteration and gives us the opportunity to evaluate more ideas. We get a better product. We might still get to a place where no, that's not a feasible idea, but the work product that we get from that is substantially better, and it's a much more inclusive idea.
Nice. Great. Fantastic. And that's a perfect setup for the challenge Sid gave to us during his. So Sid, sort of, where are you thinking about this? By the way, I like this to be an actual policy. Your only answer can be yes and. Right? Yes or yes and, but we don't accept no as an answer. Sid.
Well, you know, I'm sitting here going, even if we could print $7 million, and fill those coffers up, what happens is we would still have people going, is it an investment we ought to make?
That's
and I
right.
think the policy ought to be, as we come together for these community meetings, we need to encourage more walk audits because they do a couple of things. It needs to be a cross-section of our full city and a demographics. So we have that connectivity about why this is important.
Yeah.
And it needs to be done at different times of the day.
Good.
Because it can't always be whenever it's well lit and in the afternoon. We need to look at various uses. It comes to also other questions will come up to play as to, let's take park benches. They're not just pretty and something that you put in there because it's something you put into the plan. For accessibility, they are key when people don't think about that somebody who may not be able to walk a full block, but still wants to be part of the community, maybe because of age or a medical condition, they want to be able to have that accessibility on there as well. And it's those conversations that happen on the walk audits that will change mm-hmm. your perception of the investment that this makes.
Couldn't agree more. I've done lots of them. And by the way, you may have noticed in those photos, I showed you, we're doing them in the snow. I've been doing them in Anchorage in November and December. I've done them in the rain in Portland because that's when the water pools at the bottom of the handicap ramp, right? You know, the curb ramp. I couldn't agree with you more about sort of, and having, by the way, the people that use those facilities, people who are transit riders, who walk regularly, who bike, as the kind of the leaders on the walk audits, right? Let's get residents to lead us on the walk that they have to walk to get to a grocery store or to the transit stop that they use. Take us on that experience, that lived experience. That's fantastic.
And we need to go across all racial lines and age lines and start to think about this from various optics. And what do we need to do to have this be a real connectivity for our community?
Fantastic. And by the way, you're getting good yeses in the chat box on this. Philip Lockwood said, he, by the way, he's with Mike, he's saying, yes, and let's change the narrative to aspirational. That's a yes, and is an aspirational narrative. And what you just described are aspirational activities, I'd argue, Sid, to get out there together.
One additional kind of thought about that is I had a boss who was a wheelchair user at the architecture firm I worked at in Chicago. And one of the things he always told me was, Mike, you can just walk out of the building and go across the street, cut through cars and go to the convenience store across the street. I have to plan out every single move that I'm going to make if I'm going to go and hail a cab, because I have to know that there's a curb cut. I have to know what, you know, if I'm in a suit and I get to the bottom of the curb cut and the, you know, and so it's crucial what Sid and we're talking about as far as accessibility and yeah.
Great. Hey, Tim, do you want to throw a magic wand idea into the mix here?
I do. I've been thinking about it. So I want to hatch an idea, see if it sticks. So my magic wand idea to make it true that it's not a specialized thing is every year there'll be a field day where third graders, eighth graders, and seniors or maybe college students at the local college that are either architects or engineers will get together and they'll do design day where they all work together in multi-age groups and they come up with an idea for somewhere in the community, whether it's a streetscape or a bike lane or a trail or something like that. And they get to do that all the way through their education. So every year you get to look forward to design day, whether you're a third grader, eighth grader, senior, and then college student who's facilitating. And then your role and how much work you do in developing that concept design is then presented to the city and public works and engineering say, of all ages, we came up with this idea and we picked a roadway that we're familiar with and that we know enough about. And the amount of information you can gather depends on where you are in that school track so that everybody four times in their growing up has participated in design day and it becomes this great Peoria tradition.
Oh, I love everything about that. We did a version of that with middle schoolers where we even gave them some of the hardware. We let them build a parklet. We had hay bales and some seating and tables and things like that. And my experience with youth in particular around this, Tim, and you may want to weigh in, is that they are not bounded by what you can't do. You know, they haven't read the manual on uniform traffic control devices, or what a traffic engineer would call the MUTCD, which tells us the 9,000 reasons we can't do that, right? They don't know that the ASHTO, the American Association of State Highway Transportation Officials, design guide says we can't put that there. They just know, we live in this neighborhood, there's a park over there, and that's where we like to go play, and we'd like to get over there, and the straightest line is right here.
I agree, yeah.
Don't they just bring such an unfettered insight to that kind of work?
The enthusiasm is infectious, and I'm glad, and I have a humble brag moment, if I may. I have a nephew who is turning 18 next week, and watching him grow up and watching him be obsessed with mountain bike trails and bicycling, and he's running cross country and he's doing all of the active transportation, somewhere around like age 13 to 15, he's like, so Uncle Tim, what exactly do you do? And I explained to him, and you know, you end up reducing it to like cocktail party talk, where I was like, well, I design bike lanes. That's effectively kind of what I do. And I just found out last week that he got accepted to the University of Missouri for civil engineering. So he took that enthusiasm from a kid, and he's gonna go and maybe one day design bike lanes. So don't ever tell someone they can't do something, because he was worried he wouldn't get into that college, and he did. So I'm very excited.
Leslie, do you have a magic wand idea?
Yes, actually, I was thinking about having policies and being intentional about connectivity of all of our transportation systems. Within the city, but also regionally as well. There are so many opportunities out there. We have the Hannah City Rails to Trails. We have the Rock Island Trail and the connectivity to the Riverfront Trail. We have our bike lane systems. So the opportunities are endless. We just have to be intentional. And it'll also help us, you know, get us to thinking about collaboration and leveraging resources. And really, you know, really just being intentional about it instead of looking at infrastructure from a project perspective. And I also support Sid in the lived experience. He and I, along with our Walkability Action Institute, we just did a walk audit on Main Street in Peoria from the riverfront up to Bradley. And it was an eye-opening experience, and we've been talking about it. And we were joking with Councilman Ruck Regal that we would have him ride his bike over to Bob Michael Bridge to go to Walmart. And he would lead the council members to do that. So to go from Peoria to Tazewell County to go and get food. So
yeah, that's because you know there are people that might well be doing that, correct, Leslie?
Yeah, they're doing that now. So what is that lived experience, right? Yeah, so yeah. To be able to empathize with all populations. So
great.
I agree.
Fantastic. All right, listen, what I would love to do is one more speed round if I could. I just want to leave on the most positive note. I would love to ask each of you to tell me the thing you think gives you the greatest hope. And this can be like a 6-word answer. You don't have to, you know, and just give me your quick take on that, because then we would like to show one of those videos that ATA of what those pop-ups and demonstrations are like. Because Gabrielle, you've kind of gotten us thinking that I think you're really ready for your next one. And no, I do. A lot of what you guys were talking about sort of fed toward the idea of getting more some practical stuff. These are great educational opportunities. So would you mind if we went through one more time your great hope? What gives you hope, says, yeah, we're gonna make it. Is that okay? Can I hit you guys with this one? All right, good. So this time I'm gonna jump in. Gabrielle, I'm gonna go to you first, if you don't mind.
Yeah, I'm gonna say what gives me hope is that, you know, the different Peoria has like great stakeholders, you know what I mean? And I've only been in Peoria for a year, but like I know that Peoria has like a very strong grassroots community, you know, that really knows how to like get things done. And like when those people like get excited about something, you know, they really know how to organize themselves. So,
well, it gives me great hope, the notion that you've only been there a year and here you are, you're involved and you're sort of already at this level. That's a pretty good sign that somebody can move there and with a year be sucked into this. That's fantastic. Great. Thank you for sharing that. Mike.
I'm going to give a shout out to my friend, Angie Ostuski, who started a TikTok channel about little over a month ago, and it already has amassed 15,000 followers. And she's accounted for six new residents in the city in that very short period of time. And so people like Angie, who know the assets that our city has to offer, an incredible park district, access to have conversations with elected officials, to have a seat at the table. The fact that this is a big little town is incredible. And so we need 100 more Angies who are singing the Peoria praises from the rooftops. And so people like Angie who are not just thinking about ideas, but they're actually getting out there and telling people and doing things. That's what gives me hope.
Yeah, good, fantastic. I love that and I totally get that. Sid.
You know, this pandemic has taken so many things from us.
Yeah.
And for a lot, that's what we've been focused on. But the one thing it hasn't taken away from the people of Peoria, we are out more around in our parks, on our streets, doing walks. And it's given us more sense of community and wanting to be out there. It's proven to me people want to be around everybody else. Mm-hmm. Even if it has to be 6 feet apart and be socially distanced, you want to be around people. Mm-hmm. And that gives me hope that we're on the right track with Complete Streets and also as we move forward for the future of Peoria.
Excellent. Great. Hey, Tim, you want to toss one in here?
What gives me hope, and I'm the technical nerd, of course, so I'm going to go this route, but what gives me hope is that conversation has changed and people are no longer saying, why should I do this or what's it worth? But now people are saying, what do I do next? How do I do this? Where do we go from here? What's the next step? People are hungry and they're excited to do the things, do the work. And that's what's giving me hope.
Excellent. Leslie?
Yeah, I'm thinking of the motto, better together. And one thing about our region, and COVID has really shed the light on this, is our resiliency level. I mean, everybody has their mind made up. We're going to not just survive, but we're going to prosper. And mm-hmm. so I've been seeing that across the board, even in, you know, our most vulnerable communities, that everybody is now ready to engage and connect and, you know, just getting your education, getting a better job. You know, so that we have a momentum going that I want to, you know, I can really see us being more transformative as a result and becoming a destination place and the best city and region in the United States of America.
Nike. Uh-huh. Right there, right in the heartland. Mark.
Yes.
I'm encouraged, you know, where a lot of the comments have been around what we're experiencing in the pandemic times that we're in. But you mentioned this earlier, I think Peoria will be poised as we emerge from the pandemic as a mid-sized Midwestern
yep.
city
yep.
to be, you know, and with remote working is something that's going to be with us forever, I believe. And, you know, industries and millions of people and businesses were forced to say, how do we work remotely? They found that they can and can do it quite well. So I think when you combine what we have great bones, we've always said that about.
Yes, you do.
It's a unique city with a tremendous history, with great, the location on the river, the bluffs, the natural beauty, the park system. We have great bones and we have great people. So I think we'll be well poised to emerge truly better and attract more people and retain more people. And I am encouraged by the things we're seeing downtown, just this coalescence of multiple projects. You know, if we leverage them and work together with them, including incorporating Complete Streets, it is going to be a more attractive, competitive, great place to live, great place to work. I think we're on the doorstep of that.
I'll just give you two more from the box. Philip Lockwood pointed out, look, cold weather cities, wet cities have succeeded. You know, Portland, Minneapolis, they have some of the highest rates of bicycling and transit use in the country. And it rains incessantly in Portland, and Minneapolis and St. Paul have real winters. So there's no argument that you know, a city with topography mm-hmm. or rain or snow can't do this. We've got that evidence. And Jada put in the point, gives her hope. 65 people on this call, and astonishingly, they're still there despite the amount I've been talking. They are still with you. So clearly, people care about this. They are engaged. I think people are ready to move forward on this. That's really exciting for me to see the fantastic work you all are doing. Philip, Solvitor Ambulado, it is solved by walking. Of course it is. Wonderful. Mel or Heather, would you guys like to pop up that video?
Yep, we're ready to hit it.
And I'm just going to thank everybody for the opportunity, and panelists, you guys are spectacular. I hope I have the opportunity to work with all of you. Good. I do get to work with some of you still. I look forward to it. You're fantastic. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks, everybody. Stay tuned for the video. Here it comes, and the link is in the chat.
What if our streets were designed for everyone, no matter how they get around? What if your child could walk to school, walk on safe sidewalks and crosswalks? What if your aging parents had a safe way to get on a bus to get to doctor's appointments or the grocery store? What if your friend with a disability was able to walk or roll to the park? To start to answer these questions, the Active Transportation Alliance organized a series of pop-up traffic calming events across Chicagoland. While every street is different, the goal of these events is to help residents envision a safer, more welcoming street, no matter how you're getting around. Let's see how people benefit when their streets get a traffic calming makeover.
Roundabout does slow people down, which is a good thing. There are children on the street. It's also be good other places in town to help slow the traffic down on some of our side roads. And then as far as the crosswalk, it's very visible. That would be a help, more crosswalks like that.
So it's pretty important that we start looking and thinking about providing transportation amenities for all types of transportation. So we think that this is going to help us not only from a health perspective, from a safety perspective, but also from an economic perspective.
Most of our public input processes involves a public hearing at, you know, a formal meeting, and this is just being able to kind of see it in three dimensions and out in reality and not on a piece of paper.
So I think the input from school-age children and preschoolers all the way up to seniors is really important, because they're all part of our community and we need to know what's important to all of them. What's important to families might be a little bit different than what's important to seniors or people that have disabilities, and we want to make sure that we have accessibility for everybody.
And I see some picnic areas in the sun. I know that you can grab a beer down the street. And I was thinking that if I wasn't working, this could be a place that I would come with my wife, maybe a couple of buddies, meet them here, grab a beer, play some bags, hang out. Looks like a fun place to be.
I really like these painted crosswalks with thumbs up.
That's it, everybody. Thank you so much. Great to see you all. Thanks for chiming in. More to come.
Thanks, everyone.
Great job, everybody. All together, guys. Thanks, Anthony.
Great job, everyone.
Thanks, everyone.
Ready. Thanks.
Thanks.